Just a minute. ओके नमस्कार, मी आनंद गानू गरजे मराठी ग्लोबल तर्फे तुम्हा सर्वांचं स्वागत करतो. गरजे मराठी नी इनोव्हेशन अकॅडमी हा जो प्रोग्राम ठरवलेला आहे त्या प्रोग्रामच्या अंतर्गत आम्ही 10 बिझनेस टॉपिक्स आणि 10 टेक्नॉलॉजी ट्रॅक्स यांच्यावरती वेबिनारची सिरीज ही जी ठरवली त्याच्यामधला बिझनेस ट्रॅकमधला हा तिसरा आजची शृंखला आहे. सो आय वेलकम श्री विजय तळेळे. आजच्या प्रोग्रामची सूत्र आणि इन्व्हायटेड गेस्टना इंट्रोडक्शन करून देण्यासाठी मी हे प्रोग्राम जे मॅनेज करतात ज्यांच्या ब्रेन चाइल्ड मधून आपण हा प्रोग्राम बनवलाय अशा श्री संदीप पाध्ये, समीर पाध्ये आणि अविनाश काळे यांना इन्व्हाइट करतो. ओव्हर टू अविनाश काळे किंवा समीर पाध्ये.
थँक्स आनंदजी. So this is Avinash here from Netherlands. Warm welcome to all of you on behalf of GMG Innovation Academy Mentor Group. I hope you are enjoying this webinar series. Today we are in the fourth session of the webinar. In past we have gone through of IoT.
जो कितनी सारी कंपनीज का बोर्ड ऑफ डायरेक्टर है
बॅकग्राऊंड अबाउट इनोव्हेशन अकॅडमी ऍक्टिव्हिटीज. We are currently conducting the webinar series which conducts a range of topics both on technology as well as on the business front to help the aspiring entrepreneurs and the startup scale-ups to take advantage of this and help their own startup journeys. Last session we have also seen the success what Ajit is doing on artificial intelligence in UK and supporting a couple of startups right now. We will continue this series and we hope to have the startup acceleration program starting early next year, and this will be the foundation to have the mentors and the startup aspiring entrepreneurs connect each other. So please take advantage of this, and if you need any additional help, please connect us to Anand Ganuji through our website. Get more information from the website itself, and we look forward to make this successful with you. So with this, I would like request Samir Padde to moderate today's session. Over to Samir.
Thank you, Avinash. Good morning, everybody. Good morning. Very early good morning from California. My name is Samir Padhye. Today, after two technology back-to-back sessions for last two Saturdays, we are coming to a business skill, or what I would say is soft skill. As they say, throw a party and the chicks will come. But hey, business mode, this doesn't work every time. You really need to validate your idea and understand what you're getting into before you start your business or especially a startup. Otherwise, you end up spending a lot of money and time of your life pursuing an idea that may not have that big opportunity in front of you. So the first important thing is to have an idea, but second most important thing is to be able to validate it and understand what the size of that market is. If you don't do that study, or if you don't understand that part very well, most of your investors will not trust you. because it's not just taking a big report or big numbers and throwing the market size as your opportunity. That will be the worst thing you can do, because investors get those numbers all the time. What is really important is understand how can you carve that market and make it appropriate for your idea and understand exactly what the size of that market can be. So to understand that in detail today, we have our, today's Marathi Manus is Vijay Tadare. Vijay has done consulting all his life, and he's the really right person for this based on his experience. In 30 years ago, he started his career with Tata Consultancy. And then throughout the 30 years, he has worked in many, many different organizations as in senior positions, including senior vice president or executive vice president. And today, he's the CEO at Bhau Institute of Innovation, Entrepreneurship, and Leadership. He completed his BTech from Visitia in mechanical engineering and his MTech from IIT. We will be very fortunate to get his perspective and understand if there is a framework that can be applied to understand what the, how to validate idea and what the size is. So with that, and since we have a short time, Vijay, over to you.
Well said.
Thank you. Thank you, Samir. So let me share my presentation. Can you see my presentation?
Yes, Vijay. Coming.
Okay. Is it there?
Not yet.
No?
No.
Let me stop it. Let me just see again. Shall we start? Is it there, presentation now or not yet?
Yeah, it is there now. Idea validation and a market sizing.
Yeah. Okay. Good morning, good afternoon, and good evening to all of you who are attending this webinar today. Since you all are from the different parts of the world, it is a different time zone that you are all in. So to go this thing, today's webinar, the topic is idea validation and market sizing. As Samir was saying, Samir Paddeji said, while these topics, two topics are very related to each other, they are extremely critical aspects of a startup journey, of any startup journey. Normally, such topic, like especially these two topics, idea validation and market sizing, will require practically a full day session to with a workshop wherein you actually go through your idea and go through the validation and also define your market for that. So that's a full session. So in this 45 minutes, what I will try to cover is at a very high level session, which is giving the concepts about how one can go about idea validation, why it is required, and how to go about market sizing, which both of them are very related topics. We will be doing a detailed session once we start our accelerator program sometime in early next year. Till that time, I just wanted to give a very high level overview of this topic. Are you seeing my next topic slide? So that I just want to confirm so that.
We can see.
Okay, so then I will not ask that question again. So the today what we are going to discuss during this session is what is a typical startup journey? Like what are the different stages, main stages in a startup journey? Some of the details of each of that journey. Why normally startups fail? I think you know that a majority of startups do fail. And what is the reasons of those failure? What are the mistakes they do? What is really ideation? What is idea validation? And why it is important? And the process that one can follow to do the idea validation. A basic difference, because when you talk about market, a market segmentation or a market sizing, you need to understand who is your customer and who is your consumer. And there's a very critical difference between each of these two. And these both understanding each of these is very important from the market segmentation and market sizing perspective. So we'll discuss a couple of slides on who is a customer and who is a consumer and what are the differences. How to segment a market with an kind of an example, which I will give you how to segment a market and the process of doing that. And some concepts of TAM, SAM, SOM to help you to the market sizing. So moving forward, if you look at this infographic, there are six major stages of a startup. Every startup goes through these six stages while they start from ideation stage. Based on ideation, they get into the building a minimal viable product. That is a MVP, what is normally called in a startup ecosystem. Then you launch that MVP and you start getting customer feedback. After you get customer feedback, you again revamp that MVP and full kind of launch a full-fledged product and start getting paying customers. That's when you start customer traction, which is also important. And then once you start getting customer traction, then you look at expanding your business across different geographies, different sectors, different markets, what we you might have identified during market segmentation, and scaling your startup accordingly. And at some point in time, you decide to exit the startup and cash out, and then think of another startup. That's how normally they say serial entrepreneurs. They go through multiple of these startups. And while the startups, a lot of entrepreneurs do have a failure in their startups, they continue to be entrepreneurs because they start looking at a different startup. They start working on a different startup. So they go through the entire cycle again. So these are the major steps of a startup. If you go into really details of each one of them, if you look at ideation, ideation is basic, comes out of a problem that you are identifying and you are trying to solve a solution to that problem. You list down the pain points of a customer, find multiple solutions, finding a right solution, a problem solution fit, and exploring the competition and finding out what is your USP, what is your differentiator, what is your value proposition for that problem. Then the next step, as we talk about building MVP, build your team, design your technology, decide your technology, design your product, design your solution, do a customer profiling and market sizing. And this is exactly where, if you see, in ideation and market sizing go hand in hand. Because if you do not have a demand in the market, there is no point in doing business. Because business drives, the demand drives the business. Building an MVP also involves developing a prototype, getting it to the market, and getting paying customers and further this thing. Now, looking at this thing, let's look at why startup fails. If you look at, if I ask a question, a lot of you will say that 70-80% startup fail. But actually the fact is almost 90% of the startup fail. And when you ask a startup entrepreneur, when you generally go into the seminars or webinars and ask them, what is one of the major reason that the startups fail? Majority of them will say that need of a cash, short of funds, and some of those things. Well, those are critical and important factors for a startup to success. But for a startup, normally fails because if you see top 20 reasons of a startup, the top reason for startup failures is no market need. So you are trying to develop something which market doesn't require. And that is one of, and if you do a lot of research on the internet, you will find that this is the topmost reason why 90% of the startup fail. Okay, out of 90%, the 42% reason why they fail is no market need. Also, if you look at the top startup mistakes, the top mistake, if you see, it's building something that nobody wants. That is number one. So you are trying to, because normally as technologists, what we do is we always want to focus on technology and we don't want to, we will say that my product is so great that once I get into the market, I'm sure there will be business. It doesn't work that way. You have to verify whether there is a market need and you have to verify whether your problem, whether your solution is fitting the problem that you're trying to solve. So this is where the idea validation comes into picture. Just to say ideation, where we talked about ideation, I think a couple of weeks back, we had a session from Madhoji Dapke, which was talking about design thinking. And he gave an example of some women in Rajasthan and Haryana and Gujarat. They normally go for water, like every day they walk 5 to 6 kilometers to fetch water, and they bring it on their head in the container. Now he came up with a solution which was design thinking solution, which was saying that we could, they came up with, somebody, some entrepreneur came up with a solution which was a, on the shoulder you create a tripod on which you put the container, so that the pressure doesn't come on the head but it comes on the shoulder. There's another version of that. When you do an ideation further, this is the solution. I am sure you would have looked at this solution, this thing. So how can you identify a problem and how can you figure out a solution? That is what is called ideation. Now, if you look at the solution in the right hand side, okay, not only, if you see on the left hand side, only ladies are carrying these containers, whereas the solution that came out, can they want to do multiple trips to fetch the water. Now they can do it in one trip because the volume of the container is much bigger. It is easily movable, and even men can do it. So the solving, by solving this problem and coming with the right solution, you have expanded the reach of that solution to the even men can use that solution. So these are some of the thoughts that I wanted to just give an idea, because our topic is not innovation and ideation right now. It is more than how do you validate an idea. But to, I wanted to show, depict this picture to tell you that how does one ideates and how can you find the right solution and how does there a problem solution fit occurs. Now we will get to the directly to the idea validation. Before we actually get into the process, let's understand some of the precursor and let's look at some of the facts. When we build a product for the first time, we don't even know how many even wants that our product, because we just have an idea. We think we will be able to solve some problem in the society or industry, and we start building on a working on a product. And that's most of the products or a project start. Now, if you talk about student innovation or student startups, they start when they are doing some projects in their final year of engineering or third year of engineering, and they start working on an idea, and they think, then their professors or somebody says that, yeah, this has a potential in the market, and they start working, building the product, and they are more focused on technology. And this has been our experience. I have been managing an incubator for last 3.5 years, and we have gone through almost hundreds of ideas, and we currently support about 70 startups. So if you look at most of the technologists or the entrepreneurs are more focused on technology that they want to do, but they don't want to look at, oh, who will require the product. Okay, another fact is we assume that people have a problem. The problem that we are going to solve is very critical and important, and my solution is perfect. So these are a lot of assumptions that we do when we start working on a idea or when working on a startup. Another thing is, so what is idea validation? Idea validation is a very critical activity to perform before we invest time, money, and effort, and to ensure that we minimize the risk of no market need. As we saw, the one of the major failure of startups is no market need or building something that nobody wants. Okay, so idea validation is a very critical activity to validate and to minimize the risk of that no market need. Also, before we invest a lot of time, effort, and money, we want to verify that our product will have a market in the industry or market in the society. The consumers or customers do require that product. So to verify that, you do an idea validation. Another thing is, it is to test your idea, it is to test your market, to learn fast, and to fail fast. Normally, this is another word that is coined in the startup ecosystem, is to fail fast. Okay, it is always better to fail fast than to fail after your product is ready, because you have already spent too much of time, money, and effort. So idea validation will help you to fail fast. It will help you to remove your assumptions and see clearly, you will be able to figure out that, yes, there is a market or there is no market, or do I need to change my products or solution so that it is required for the market, or it is a good problem market or problem solution fit or a problem market fit. So what is idea validation? As we saw in the last slide, it is a verification of your assumptions. We assume that there is a problem or a pain point. We assume your solution. So verification of those assumptions to get a feedback from the customer that the problem and solution fit is right, what you are thinking. There's also a term that is normally coined as a product market fit in the startup journey. And that product market fit is also exactly similar to the basis of product market fit is a problem solution fit. If problem and solution fit is there, then you at least have a verification that there's a market for your product. Okay. Then you try to build your product such a way that what market requires. So that's a product market fit. And same thing, verification of the need from the market for your solution. Validation and confirmation that customers are willing to pay for it. Now, this is another factor that you can validate when you do idea validation. Is not only you verify that there's a problem, not only you verify the pain points, you verify the solution, not only you verify the product and market fit, but you also verify the customers will be willing to pay for that solution. Because without, if there is no revenue and customers are not willing to pay, then there is no business. So there is no entrepreneurship or a startup. So we need to ensure that they are ready to pay. Paying customer is one of the most important requirement for having a business. Also, to make sure your product and business idea has a potential. Now, that potential is something that we will look at when we do the market sizing and market put. So not only that, yes, there are customers who are wanting this solution, but what is the volume of that customer? What is the potential of those customers? That will help you to imagine as to how much revenue can you generate. And that's where the TAM, SAM, SOM come into picture. We will discuss that later. How do you do about this? Now, we have discussed why idea validation is important. Now, how do you go about doing this idea validation? The first step to idea validation is you list down all your assumptions. Now, what are your assumptions? Is your idea, what your idea or whatever your solution that you are thinking in detail? What problem your idea is solving? List down that, or what pain points your idea is solving? Who is your customer? It will be clarified once we clarify who is your customer and consumer, or who is your end user. I can just differently, we can say who is your customer and who is your end user. Pain points of the customer. How are you solving the problem? What are the solution? What are the features of your problem? Normally, there is a difference between, I just listed these three words here, features, benefits, and value. There's a very critical difference between each one of them also. Lot of times as a engineers and technologist, we focus on features because that is what, when you listen to most of the startup pitches, they will tell you our product will provide this functionality, but that is technical functionality. Have you looked at how that feature is leading to a benefit to the customer? It is just not the benefit, then how that benefit is going to add value to the customer? Because what defines your price for your product is not based on the features, but it is based on the value that you are passing on to the customer. Your price, a lot of times we sell, the startups also say that, oh, I am going to develop a solution or a product which is 50% of the existing price that is there in the market, where we have a competing product, but I will be developing it at 50% price. But that is not the right way to think. You need to think, if your product is passing on a value which is much more than the existing competing products, and then you are giving a price which is lower than the competition, then you are actually multiplying the value for the customer. Okay, so that's how one needs to look at, not just a price as one factor. And we just remember these features, benefits, and value. When the startups are pitching, they must need to look at all the three aspects. Features are from the technology perspective. Benefits and value is from the customer perspective. So they belong to the business aspect of your product. Features belong to your technology, technical aspects of your product. Now, once you have listed down all your details of what is your idea, what is your problem, what is your solution, who is the competition, kind of a thing. How much, what are your features, benefits and values. Now you get to the market. Now you try to find out, do a market touch. In the sense, what you do is, based on what you think is your initial customer, okay, you try to define the target market. You try to define the characteristics of that market. When we will come to this in the market segmentation and market sizing in detail, okay? How do you define the characteristics of the market? There are multiple aspects that you need to look at to define the character. Who is the end user? What is the application? How are they going to use the product? Why are they going to use the product? What is they use the product? I also given an example how you define these characteristics of the market. What is the size of the market? Is it a right time to enter the market? Lot of times there are some startup ideas, they are early in the game in the market, like market is not mature to accept that product. Or sometimes you already enter into the market when there are too many similar products are there in the market. So you have a huge competition. Unless you have a very compelling reason to get into the market with a very huge differentiator, then it is not time to enter the market when there are too many people. When you are early in the entering in the market, also it is the right not time, because the consumers or customers are not able to understand your product and not able to understand how they can use it, or they are not mature enough to use that product. So that timing is also fairly important. Is there a competition? We have been discussing that. What is a differentiator? What is going to be your business model? This is also important from the perspective of defining your, validating your idea, whether you are going to sell product to a businesses, or you are going to sell it to the consumers, or is it B2B, business to business, business to consumer, business to business to consumer, or a business to government? Because some products are built for government consumption. So you need to define. There is also now coming to direct to consumer, D2C, means what we are talking about, farmers' produce is directly being given to the end users and consumers without through a mechanism. So that's a direct to the consumer or direct to home. Also, we need to, when you do a market research for the idea validation, you also need to define at what price point customers are willing to purchase your product. Because this is also important. Like, you might think that, okay, I'm giving at a 50% discounted this thing. That might be true for initial period, but you also need to make money. You need to make profits. So you understand approximately at what price point you will be able to sell the product in the market. But you also, it is not the product or the business doesn't happen based on what you think you will be able to sell the at your price. The product or business happens, the business or this thing happens only when customers are willing to purchase the product at that price. Okay. So you need to really understand at what price point customers are willing to purchase the product. Now, the first step is list down everything. Second step is do the market research about what you have listed. Now, how do you do this market research? Okay, then before that, one more step that you know we will do, think about it. Once you have defined some level of market, you start building your MVP, which is a working prototype, and doing a beta launch, alpha launch, beta launch, like that, so that you test that in the market. Okay, and you beta launch means you give it to the close group of 15, 20 customers or consumers and try to figure out what is their feedback and which is very minimum features that you want to build in the prototype, so that customers are willing to understand the product well and customers are willing to tell you that, yes, this product will be suitable for their requirements. So once you launch it to the beta customers, it is not a large audience, but it must be from the target audience. Those you think who are the probable customers. If it is not from the target audience, then it is not worth it. You also, through the working prototype, you also get a detailed feedback from these early customers and refine it further. Now, how do you go about this market research and idea validation and these things? So while you are doing this idea validation, you can also create a dashboard, which is about whatever your assumption that you have prepared. In the dashboard, you can have multiple blocks One of the block will be customer hypothesis or customer assumption that you have made. The problem hypothesis, the solution hypothesis, the core assumptions. What are the risk case assumptions that you are doing? That if you go wrong, the completely product becomes useless. So you list down all these things, which you have done in the first step itself, but you put it in the dashboard. And when you do the market research and when you do the idea validation, when you go to the market, next slide, we will see how you do that. You will get to know that some of these assumptions are right, some of these assumptions are wrong. Something you will get to know better than what you thought, because customers will come back to you that their thinking is different. So you then list down what are the validated assumptions and what are the invalidated assumptions. So that is the output of your idea validation. The ultimate output of that is whether you want to proceed developing the prototype, whether you want to proceed developing the entire product, or you want to pivot. Now, pivot is another term that is some of you might have heard it, some of you might not have heard it. It is basically changing your thought process. Part of the product and part of the solution is keeping it same, but you are changing the entire philosophy such a way that you are trying to get your product market fit right, so that you develop your product so that it is right for the market. And that's what pivoting of a solution means. And pivoting can happen at a multiple stages. One of our startup pivoted after 2 years of their first product. I'll give an example also of later that, or I can talk right now. Initially, they started providing a two-wheeler garage services on road as well as at your doorstep. So if you have a two-wheeler and it breaks down on the road, you just call a particular number and they will come and collect the vehicle and get it repaired to you at your home doorstep. Or they will come to your doorstep, pick up the vehicle and bring it back to you repaired. Or they started having a booths or the workshop, which is a moving workshop kind of a thing, moving garage, which is near the office complexes. So they will put it there. Whenever employees come to the office, they put the vehicle for repair. Evening, it is repaired and serviced and they take it back. So this was their original model. But then they realized for this, if they want to scale it, if they want to do all India basis, they will require so much of labor. They will require a lot of such workforce, and profitability and viability was not becoming so right. So what they did, they pivoted. Now they had an entire 2 years of data as to what customers look for in maintenance, how the garages do it, what is the profitability on different components as well as labor. So all that they did analysis, and they built a SaaS-based software for the unorganized sector of two-wheeler and three-wheeler and four-wheeler garages. And now they have sold that to almost 3,000 plus garages in India in just 1.5 years. So they pivoted, but they pivoted based on their core knowledge. So that also you can do. That's an example of pivoting. Coming to the idea validation, how do you do it? You can do it through research on published papers. You can do the questionnaires. The best is doing questionnaire and surveys online, offline, meeting the customer, interviewing them using social media, Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, WhatsApp. Or once you are ready with the MVP, you can develop a smoke test site landing page so that people can use it as a beta launch. And then you can do the Google Analytics on them and see how they are doing it and how they are traversing through the application or the your app, product or software and some of these things. So these are the ways we can do the idea validation. Now, there is one more. I wanted to just give a gist of this evaluation framework, what we do as a startup or innovation evaluation framework. And this is also useful for you once you have thought about an idea. Also, this can be used. And this is framework was given actually by our Garje Marathi global chairman, Dr. Raghunath Mashelkar, as well as he's a chairman of our advisory board of Bahu Institute and a great scientist and a Padma Vibhushan. His framework is called Assured Innovation Framework. There is a assured has a lot of meaning. Affordable. A means affordable. Is your product or your solution is affordable to the industries, community, society? Is it scalable? How much scale it can attain? Is it sustainable in the long run? Is it universal or user friendly? Or is it global? It can be sold globally. Is it rapid? Can it be developed quickly? How is it excellent? Basically, excellence or excellent? Is it the best product in that space? Is it distinctive or different, or is it unique? So this is the framework. If you apply this to your idea also, you can get a lot of things. And if you have, since the Assured framework itself, we can talk for half an hour or something. And Dr. Mashalkar can also talk for a couple of hours on this. Yesterday only I heard him talk about Gandhian engineering, and there also he was talking about Assured. So if you want to go into details of this framework, you can go it on the net also, you can get it, or you can read a book by Dr. Mashalkar and Dr. and Ravi Pandit. The book is Leapfrogging to Pole Vaulting. And one full chapter, I think the third chapter, is completely dedicated to Assured framework. And what we have realized is, you can apply this framework at the startup idea. You can apply this framework at the 2 years after your startup is at a stage where you have started earning revenue. You can apply this framework at a scaling stage where you are earning 10, 20 crore of revenue, and whether you want to scale it up to the higher this thing. You can apply it. Even organizations are taking this framework to apply it for them, because what they are providing services or what they are providing products, whether they fall into this framework. So this is a great framework. You can look at this later. You can read the book or you can get it on the net also. So coming back to our next point, where that we want to talk about market sizing. And before we want to get into market sizing, I wanted to spend a couple of slides on who is a customer and who is a consumer. Customer is somebody who pays for your product or service, and a consumer is somebody who ultimately uses your product. Sometimes customer and consumer are same, and sometimes they are different. An example is a small kid, and kids want to buy toys. Okay, they play with toys. Who pays for the toys is their parents or their relatives. But who uses the product? The product is used by the kid. So when you are building a product, you have to look at both. But who is the influencer and who is a driver for your product? The driver is your consumer. Because if the kid likes a toy, he will force the parents to buy it. Okay? And parents will buy it at a price. So this is just to give a differentiation between who is a customer and who is an end user. Customers also can resell their product. As an example of your business model of B2B2C, customers, when they buy a product, they sell it. Like the best example is Amazon. Okay? Amazon buys products from different vendors and sells it to the consumers. Okay? So customers can resell the products, whereas a consumer doesn't resell the product. It's a consumer. They consume it themselves. Customer need to purchase the product for using it. Consumers do not need to purchase the product. Sometimes they need to directly purchase it, but most of times, when they are together, when they are same, consumer and customer is same, then they will purchase it. But mostly customers need to purchase it. Motive is either to consume or resell. Motive is only for consumption. Okay. Customer can be an individual or an organization, where a consumer can be individual, family, or member of an organization. This is the basic. I think it is more a generic this thing, but I'm sure you all understood the difference between who is a customer and who is a consumer. And both are important, let me tell you. But the demand is driven by the consumers. The price point, the purchasing, and those are defined by customer. Now, these are not the only two factors that comes into when you want to look at the product selling. Okay, there is something called decision making unit, which we'll discuss on the next slide. So, as I said, customers create the demand for the market. Actually, it is created by the consumers. So if you look at, there are different types of consumers who create the demand. There are commercial consumers, there are discretionary spending consumers, extrovert consumers, low income consumers. Now, consumers, and based on this type of consumers, also your market will differ. Commercial consumers, that means B2B, because they are buying it to sell it to somebody. Whereas next three, discretionary spending consumers, extrovert and low income consumers, are the B2C type of consumers. Okay. These consumers, if you have discretionary spending consumers, then they are using it. They have multiple buying patterns. They can buy it at a high price. They can buy it at a low price. They buy it throughout the year because they have a discretionary spending. They have a money which they can spend. Extrovert customers are the different consumers are different type of consumers. They also have a lot of money, but they only buy on the branded products, or they only buy a high-end products because they want to show off. Whereas if you look at low-income consumers, they are the people who look for purchasing at a lower price, at a cheaper products, but their volume is so high that you can also just define your product for low-income consumers. So when you define your market, some of these aspects and some of these concepts come into picture. Also, when you might have to look at when you are actually go to the market, I want to just give this concept here. There's something called decision-making unit that you need to worry about. It is just not the consumers who are also called as champion or a customer are important. There is something called influencers, veto power, and purchasing department, and that kind of a thing. So they also have to be thought through when you are thinking of a product, like, or in the selling in the product in the market. Champion is again end user or your consumer. Primary economic buyer is something who is a customer who is spending money. Influencer, these are the experts in the industry. Lot of times if you see, whenever you look at a product, technology product, you look at Gartner's magic quadrant. Why you look at that? Because somebody has, expert has done a research, and they have defined that your product falls in this particular quadrant of Gartner's magic quadrant. So that is influencing the buyers, saying that I should buy this product because this is already researched. So these are the influencers. Person with a veto power. Okay, in a B2B scenario, business to business especially, somebody in the industry or somebody in the your organization whom you are selling the product has a veto power, saying that no, you have to buy from these only. There's also a purchasing department which plays a role in B2B scenario, who also has a lot of power to decide who should they buy from. So this is just to think when you are going to the market for actually selling your product and your sizing, you might come across this group also who can give you a lot of value-added inputs to define your product market fit. Now we will move to the market segmentation and market sizing for next 15 minutes. Now we have discussed how do you validate your idea, you define, you list down everything, you do the market research, you validate it, then you define who is consumer, who is your customer. But now you have defined your customer and consumer, but how do you define your market? Because the market, there can be multiple opportunities that market has, your product has. So actually you start listing down all market opportunities for your idea. So there can be multiple industries that your product can be sold to, or there can be specific industries it can be sold to. So define all the industries that you think your product can be sold to. Within that industry, define who would be the benefit, who is the end user, rather than customers, because end user categories. Subdivide each category further. List out different tasks done by the subcategory. And then group these subcategories to come up with a characteristic set for that end user and for that market. Okay. Just to give you an example of this. Okay. Let's see, you have a startup which is developing a software to improve education with technology, hardware, software product, or software product, which is called a technology, and to help the improving the education. Now, how will you go about defining your market for this? So who are your end users? Somebody say education means only teachers. No, teachers, administrators, parents, students, all are your end users. They have a different role to play when you look at this technology platform that you are playing. Just take an example of Byju's. Okay, Byju's end users are teachers, administrator, parents, and students. While teachers, they are all there. Okay, now if you want to take further next step as to now you have defined your end users. Now how do you define further subdivided or segmented? Okay. Now, whether these end users are from primary school, secondary school, graduate school, private tuition. So this is a different flavor of each of these category of end users. Whether the teachers are from primary school, whether teachers are from secondary school, or from graduate school, or they are from the private tuitions. Whether parents are approaching the primary school, whether students are from this factor. Now, once you have defined this, again, you can further subdivide it is each primary school, if you look at it just, it can be a public school, it can be a private school, or it can be just a homeschool teachers. Now, if you look at further, so want to subdivide the public school itself, it can be in an urban area, it can be in a semi-urban area, it can be in a rural area. Further, if you divide it further, whether in an urban area, whether there is a one teacher per subject, with multiple teachers per subject, or there are multiple subjects per teacher. Now, if you look at it, now you want to build your software product for improving the education with your technology. You might want to start looking at, sometimes you might look at just, okay, let me look at, this is going to be helpful to teachers and students. Okay, let me start talking to teachers and students. But if you look at the next four subdivisions of the market, you will realize that you need to go down to the such as dividing market segmentation so that you actually reach out and you find out what is real need for your product. How are you going to improve the education if it is a one teacher per subject in an urban area or in a rural area, in a private school in rural area? Because if you look at combination of each of these factors, okay, they will drive what your product is requirement. They will also drive how much they will be ready to pay. They will also drive whether your product requires some prerequisites which are available in rural area, which are not available in rural area, but which are only available in urban areas. Then you might want to define your market as an urban schools. In urban, it is not available in public school. You might want to define it in the private school. If you are looking at a market which is a very high price software, then it can be only used by private schools in urban areas. Okay, it might be not useful for primary school, it might be used for graduate school or secondary school. So this way you can define the market for your product and you can segment your market. Now the step one is brainstorm all the market opportunities, then you start segregating them after similar characteristics. So narrow down. So you want to narrow down the market opportunity to 5-6 opportunities, because you cannot do the market sizing for entire all across. You have to start doing it from your beachhead market. I will come to the what is beachhead market. So you list down 5-6 interesting market opportunities after you do the segmenting. Then for each of that market opportunity, you create a matrix. Now, how do you define this market? How do you narrow down? These are the criteria that you can kind of use it. Okay. Some of the questions that you want to throw, want to consider when you want to define 5-6 or narrow it down to 5-6 market opportunities is the target customer well funded? Can they afford to buy your product? Is the target customer readily accessible to your sales team? That means you are working in some city and you are trying to access into the market which is in a different state, which is far away, and it is not accessible to your sales team. Immediate, these are target immediate markets. Does the target customer have a compelling reason to buy this product? Can you deliver the whole product yourself or you need partners to deliver it? Is there a competition that can block you? If you win this segment, can you expand or leverage it? Also, you might, when you start, think of startup, you might have defined some values, passions, and goals for your team. Does it align with those values? Okay. Sometimes you might come up with a product which you want to sell drink or a liquor, and your value is not to sell that, but you want to help the end user, which is to avoid drinking, then it doesn't gel together. So you need to look at all these aspects when you want to narrow it down. Once you narrow it down to 5-6 markets, now you want to identify one beachhead market, which you will focus on defining your market size or TAM SOM, which will be the final SOM, which you will start validating. You are doing your market research. The other thing next you can do it also is, once you have defined these 5-6 market segments, you can also create a matrix kind of a thing. For each of these market segment, you can define who is your end user, because it can be different for each market segment. What application they use, what benefits and value you are passing to the customer, who are the influencing customers or early adopters, what are the market characteristics, partners, size of the market, competition. Complementary assets is basically, it's not that you are able to provide a complete solution, but you might want to package your solution with two or other three solutions and provide a solution and complete solution to the customer. When you do this matrix, you have defined your market one, market two, market three, market four, market five, market six, and you have, these are the your rows. Now you got a matrix by which you will be able to identify your beachhead market. Now, what is a beachhead market? Okay. If you know World War II, there was 1944 when Allied forces wanted to take over the mainland Europe, which was Nazi controlled. They followed a beachhead strategy. What they did was, they landed on a Normandy beach. From there, they entered into the mainland Europe, and they could capture the Nazi-controlled these things. So basically, just to give an example, your beachhead market is something which you want to land your product there, and then you can easily expand your product into the allied markets or aligned markets or different markets which are aligned to that beachhead market. So you can expand very easily from that base. So you identify that beachhead market. Then you'd identify, you have already identified this, your end user profile and market research segment in step three for your all the markets. You already defined that for your beachhead market also. You further refine it if you want to and do the market research on those things. Again, you can do the market research using the same philosophy that we discussed in idea validation by the public research papers, Gartner's, these institutes, or actual surveys, talking to the customer directly, questionnaires through the social media and those on. Now let's last few slides I want to spend on TAM, SAM, SOM. So what is TAM, SAM, SOM? Once you have defined your beachhead market, or you want to define, once you have defined your total market and you want to define your beachhead market, the TAM, SAM, SOM refers to that. So what is TAM, what is SAM, and what is SOM? TAM is the total addressable market. SAM is the serviceable addressable market, which is part of the TAM. And SOM is the serviceable obtainable market, or sometimes we call share of market. Okay, so that is SOM. Now, how do you define these things? Now, if you look at, based on what we have discussed so far, okay, TAM could be, total addressable market could be for all your market opportunities that you think you would like to capture. Okay, whatever you might have listed down or thought through when you are doing the idea validation, you would have come out market opportunities, which could be 12-15 markets that you want to target. So that total addressable market is TAM. Now SAM is, out of that you have identified your 5-6 market segments, that is your immediately you want to address. Okay, that is serviceable addressable. So TAM is revenue potential for the entire market. Naturally, it is excluding competition. It's a holistic revenue opportunity. SAM is the realistic market that you think you would like to, 5-6 opportunities that you identify, which fit, which are able to give you a great market, product market fit, as well as problem solution fit for your problem and your solution. That is the SAM. Okay. It can be across geographies. And it is what you want to target for your startup. Now, share of market is actually the last what you did, the beachhead market. Okay. So, revenue potential of your beachhead market, but including the competition. Okay. Now, first TAM and SAM does not include the competition because it's a market size. Okay. And all these are TAM, SAM, SOM are the market potential in the dollar terms. That means it's in the revenue terms. So once you define who is your end user, what is the size of that end user, what is the price point that end user would like to buy, your different types of your models of your product, revenue models. Based on that, you will end up with a, what is the TAM potential, SAM potential, and SOM potential. It is a revenue potential, but you need to understand the market size for getting to revenue potential. There are two general approaches that to define your TAM, SAM, SOM when you want to define it for your markets. One is a top-down approach. Basically, you start from the market research that is available, this thing, and start segmenting your market and coming down to your lowest level of aggregation, and then defining that market size or the customer size or end user size and multiplying it with the pricing to get the TAM. You can also approach the bottom up approach, where you start from the lowest end user that you have identified in your metrics that you have defined for your market. Try to find out how many such end users satisfy your characteristics of your product and the market. Start extrapolating it further up, saying that if they are within your city are 500, then within the state will be 50,000, within a country it will be 5 million, like that. So actually, TAM will lead to top down approach will lead to a higher TAM, whereas bottom up approach will lead to a conservative TAM. So the best way is to combine both of these. We tell our startups is you start both ways, and somewhere you will find out that there is a match between what you are getting and your addressable markets. That is the best way to do it. It's not one or the other, but it's a combination of both of these two. Just to give an example, I mentioned about this organized sector, which is 2- and 4-wheeler garages. So how do you define a TAM for that? It's a number of such garages across India and developing countries in Asia. If you look at Vietnam and some of these countries, also there are a lot of two-wheeler usage. Okay. The SAM is basically the number of garages in tier one cities that you want to approach first, rather than entire India. So focus of the startup initially, it can also be selected tier one cities like Maharashtra to start with. SOM could be, there are a couple of more competing products, like there are three more products are there already in the market. So your SOM is 33% of SAM. Also, if you want to start in Pune, Mumbai first, then that could become your SOM. Within that, the competition will also play it a picture. If we assume there is a more products to come up while we capture entire SOM, it can reduce further. Okay. Revenue model. Also, now for this, you need to define, while we define the how many garages are there, that is just the number you will get. But now in each garage, what is the size of a garage? How many job cards they generate? Whether they generate 10 job cards a month, whether they generate 10 job cards a day, and they serve 300 two-wheelers in a month. Okay. And what is the revenue model? Is it a subscription-based per job card? So initial subscription for your software product and a per job card charge of 2 rupees or 3 rupees or 4 rupees, then how much commission you will get. So these are the different ways you will create a TAM, SAM, SOM for your market. Another example is startup we have is they are developing a holistic solution for health issues of women, mostly the younger women. This is I think some of you might have heard of PCOS and PCOD. Which is polycystic ovarian syndrome or polycystic ovarian disease. Okay. For that, the way we went about creating a TAM, SAM, SOM is, if you look at the TAM, number of women in the age group of 15 to 40, because when we did our research, we found that the age group of 15 to 40 are more prone to this kind of disease, okay? And especially more prone in developing countries as well as developed countries and developing countries and women in this group. So this is entire TAM, okay? Then when you talk about SAM, we wanted to focus on India and tier one, tier two cities, because the stress is one of the major reason for these kind of issues. And tier one, tier two cities, women in the 15 to 40 years of age have a PCOS and PCOD. And we also knew 35% of women in this age group get PCOS and PCOD. So we could get the number exactly. And SOM was, we wanted to start launching the product in Mumbai, Pune, and few regions. So we decided that this is where we will, this is our share of market. And since there was no such competing product, we said, okay, we can capture the entire market. And again, by multiplying the number of women who you came with this TAM, SAM, SOM classification, you multiply with the revenue model to get your actual market potential in the dollar terms. So in summary, what we have discussed is how do we, a startup goes through what different phases? Why is ideation and idea validation is very important? How idea validation and market sizing is also linked to each other? How they are related? Who is a consumer? Who is a customer? Also, how do you do idea validation? How do you do market research? How do you market segmentation? How do you do market sizing? And the concept for market sizing like TAM, SAM, and SOM. I think, I hope this session was fairly useful. If you need to reach out to me, you can also reach out, send an email to me at ceo.bau@coep.ac.in. And I'll be ready to answer if anybody has any questions. Thank you. I will stop sharing the screen.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Vijayji. Avinash, please take over. It was an excellent presentation. Avinash, can you invite Dr. Rutush Deshpande?
Yes, Sananji. Thank you so much, Vijayji. Excellent presentation and excellent topic for a startup. I hope most of us could get right information through this session. And I would like to now invite Rutush to share his experience about his startup. Over to Rutush.
Hello.
Rutush, you have 5 to 10 minutes. We are little, yeah.
Right, so I'll pitch quickly go through my startup pitch deck, and then we'll, if anybody has any question, we can talk about it. Yeah. So, hello everybody. This is Dr. Rutush Deshpande. I'm a co-founder of a startup called Go Vidyut Mobility. Tell you about my background, I'm a battery scientist. Worked on lithium-ion batteries for last 12 years with companies such as Ford Motor Company, General Motors, Rivian, etc. In United States. And then I recently moved back to India with Mobility, my primary motivation to work. Go Vidyut Mobility is India's first extended range electric two-wheeler startup. What kind of product we are bringing you. As you know, India is the largest two-wheeler market in the world. About 22 two-wheelers were sold in 2018-19. But still there are problems. For example, most of the two-wheelers currently are petrol-based two-wheelers. And as we know, or gasoline-based two-wheelers. And as we know, gasoline-based two-wheelers have high emissions. Most of our urban area, cities, or even smaller towns are highly polluted. In fact, India hosts 20 out of 40 most polluted cities. So there needs a solution to this problem. At the same time, these gasoline two-wheelers are expensive to drive. A typical gasoline two-wheeler costs around 1.7 to 2 rupees a kilometer. So vehicles such as Activa or Jupiter would cost around 2 rupees a kilometer. Of course, there is a solution. Electric vehicles are coming all around the world. Every big OEM is working on electric vehicle solution. One of the best thing about electric vehicles is they are much cheaper to drive, especially in countries such as India, where electricity is much cheaper.
So for a two-wheeler solution, electric would cost around 30 paise per kilometer. So about 70% cheaper than a gasoline two-wheeler. But still, there is not much of market acceptance to these electric products. There are a lot of companies who are trying to bring electric two-wheeler products, but there is not much of market acceptance. And then the reason is there are a lot of issues with the electric vehicles, the existing electric vehicles. Many of them are low performing. So examples are like Hero bikes or Yo bikes. These are very, their top speed is 30, 40, 50 kilometers per hour. And users are used to high speed vehicles. At the same time, there are some high speed electric two wheelers available, such as Ather Energy or Bajaj Chetak for that matter. But these are much more expensive vehicles than the normal Activa or Jupiter. And then biggest problem about the electric two-wheelers or electric vehicles in general in India is the poor infrastructure. So of course there are no charging stations. In fact, the uninterrupted electricity is still a challenge in majority of India. So I come from a town called Nanded, so probably tier three city, and we still don't get electricity every day. So there is a few hours of load shedding almost every second day. So poor infrastructure is a challenge. How would you charge your vehicles if you don't have electricity? So that basically causes range anxiety, and have basically these vehicles would have reliability issues, even though these are green vehicles and cheaper vehicles to drive, etc. So we want to come up with a creative solution which will give the reliability of a gasoline vehicle. At the same time, it could be budget friendly, and it would have a greener element of an electric vehicle. That's where we basically came up with this particular idea. It's extended range electric two-wheeler. Now, extended range vehicles are available in United States, Europe, everywhere in the four-wheeler space. The idea in this particular case is a user will charge their vehicle at home, drive a distance more than the average commute distance on the charge battery. And for any longer drive, there would be a range extender system that will assist the vehicle to drive vehicle further. So the total range you will get on this product would be around 200 kilometers. So you don't need to worry about finding a charging station outside your home. You can just drive as long as you want and come back home, charge it at home. The best part of this solution, or the particular design that we came up with, again, this is a patent pending design, that it reduces the upfront cost significantly. So the vehicle becomes cheaper. At the same time, we are giving a reliability of the vehicle. So you can go as long as 200 kilometers. And you're not dependent on the charging station infrastructure. So there is a significant reduction in the usage cost. There is about 70,000 rupees saving for an end user compared to a gasoline vehicle in 5 years of usage. And then the most important point is you don't need the charging station infrastructure or even uninterrupted electricity. It doesn't bother your vehicle anymore because you can always drive your vehicle with the range extender system and you will charge it whenever you have electricity available. So the solution works not only in cities, but in the tier threes, towns, or even smaller villages where we don't have continuous electricity. So there is no long range anxiety, and at the same time, the user is saving a lot of money, and it's a green solution. Of course, two-wheeler market in India is very big. It's one of the biggest markets in the world, and especially the electric segment is supposed to grow at around 60% to 90% in the coming years, as if we bring the right products to the market. Currently, the products do not satisfy the needs of the end users. In terms of competition, of course, we will be competing with the traditional vehicles such as Honda Activa, or the high-powered electric vehicles such as Ather Energy, or low-powered electric scooters such as Hero Flash. if we compare in terms of various parameters, we realize that Govidyut vehicle is much cheaper to buy as compared to a high-powered Ather. It is much cheaper in terms of operational cost against a vehicle such as Honda Activa. At the same time, we are giving high performance of 80 kilometers per hour of maximum range, the maximum speed, 200 kilometers range. So we are giving the reliability, and we will have minimal tailpipe emissions. The idea would be a user would drive you the most of the time. A user will drive it on a charged battery at home. And once a while they want to go longer distance, the range extender will kick in and it will act basically as an onboard charger. And probably around 15 to 20% of the time a user would need to use the range extender. Go-to-market strategy, we are looking at starting with women professionals as our target market, because we think women are more environmentally conscious and they are cost-conscious customers, and they could be the woman driver segment is growing rapidly in India, and that's why we are focusing on our design for women users in India, in urban India at this moment.
Rutuji, you have 2 more minutes. You have 2 more minutes.
Okay, well, then we will move to B2B segment later. Started this idea in around November 27. That's when we basically applied for a patent. We built a team. Now we are in phase one, where we started. We built a prototype. We are building a prototype, and we will. We are going through the product development stages. We plan to launch this vehicle by 2021. Currently, the target market is Pune, and then we will go to the other cities gradually. In 2023, we will expand it more to the B2C segment. So proof of concept, we are being incubated in IIT Delhi, and this is our proof of concept. So recently we built this proof of concept, and we are trying to improve it day by day.
The video is not working though.
Video not working, so it's okay. Rutuj, share your contact details. People can contact you directly. And
Share your website, and I think that should be good enough. And all the best, Rutuj, for your startup. And we wish you a great success. And GMG would definitely help whatever best possible.
Of you for giving me this opportunity to present, and also the listener, thanks for patiently listening to the COVID pitch. Thank you
so much. And so Anandji, with this I would wrap up the session. We will take the Q&A maybe through emails, right, Anandji?
And because we have overrun, there was few good questions. And can I just sum up this small thing? The good session is a session wherein you get a lot of questions, and good session is a session wherein everybody has understood what a presenter has to say. And I suppose today's session was such that whatever Dr. Vijay Talleri had said, it was so impressive and so informative that I don't think anybody has any doubts in his mind. Though there are a few more questions. One is from Hemant Joshi, particularly to the pharmaceutical industry. It is one. That question is there, Dr. Hemant Joshi. But we will, I think, answer those questions via email. Avinash, please take over and wrap up the session.
Yeah, thank you so much, Anandji. So with this, I think we will end today's session. And we look forward to see you again next Saturday, where we are having Shrikant Nistane from United States briefing us about the mobility space. And we look forward to see you again next week. Yeah. And have stay safe, stay healthy. See you next week.
Thank you very much, Vijayji. An excellent
presentation. Thank you.
Thank you.
I am ending the session.
Okay. Thank you.